before there's hope for tomorrow, we must first embark on the darkest hour.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to The Darkest Hour. I'm your host, Amanda Jane. There are so many different kinds of fear out there. Scared of spiders, snakes, of being alone. But whether you're afraid of the dark or afraid of something else, fear is the commonality here. So different, yet so the same. That feeling of utter hopelessness when encountering our fears. It's universal. What makes us so unique is how each of us handles ourselves in the face of fear. And it's those actions responding to fear that bring us these stories. So, let's get started, shall we? I recently read an article, which I've attached in case you're interested, that described a similar experience to the ones my family had while living in our first house. The similarity that got me, that made me recall these events, was a mimic. I didn't have a word for it before. Our family always referred to this as a copycat, though mimic is more sophisticated, really getting to the root of what this thing is doing. It was our first house, and we loved it. We've since moved on, living relatively far away from where all of these experiences took place. The house was built in the 1960s, and the owners that we'd bought it from were an elderly couple. They'd lived there for years. Shortly after purchasing the property and the home, we'd seen that there was a family graveyard in the backyard, essentially. Four headstones dating back to the 1800s. Hardly legible, other than the year itself on two of them, which was 1892. My husband and I were not superstitious or anything like that. If anything, we thought it was pretty great that we had a piece of history attached to this place. We also thought that it was nice that whoever built this house just a few decades ago had also decided to preserve the area. So the graveyard, or any graveyard really, not a deal breaker. We weren't able to find any information on the family, really, and seeing that the graves went back to the late 1800s, I thought we might not really ever know. All was well for quite some time, and the first experience was actually reported by my husband. This happened on the left side of our house, where the playroom and the laundry room are. This would later be deemed the no-no side by our youngest. My husband had been watching cartoons with our daughter in the playroom. He described becoming overwhelmingly tired, and that he must have just fallen asleep on the floor. He woke up, and he felt like somebody was in the room. He looked over towards the back corner of the room, where he saw a dark mist appear near the closet on the ceiling, and then evaporate. He moved our daughter to her room after that, and when he told me about it, I tried to ease his concerns, reminding him of sleep paralysis and bad dreams. But he insisted he was not asleep, saying it was in the same breath that he saw the thing evaporate, and he took our daughter to her room. Not long after his experience, I had one of my own. While the kids were napping, I was cleaning the playroom. While bending over to pick up some random toys, I saw the door to the closet start to close. Right when I looked at it, the door slammed shut. I shimmied out of the room pretty quick and called my husband. I think he was almost relieved that someone else had seen something. We had no idea what exactly to do. So, my husband suggested playing some positive music or opening the windows. Something that he read, I guess. Not having any real plan of my own, I began opening all of the windows, and I put a random playlist on of studying music. Since I'd given up on putting the toys away, I decided to do some laundry, and I felt a bit sick when I walked past the playroom and saw that the closet door was now wide open. Ever since then, that door has closed or opened on its own multiple times. Up until we had eventually moved, I would occasionally get very panicked when near the basement door. This was the first thing that I noticed our kids were wary of as well. They never wanted to be near that door, and they never wanted to go down there. I suppose this could be chalked up to something that most people don't like, but the feeling was different. And the fear that my kids were showing me, well, it was real. It wasn't long after our own experiences that our children also had experiences of their own. They named the left side of the house the no-no side, our youngest telling us that someone told her no-no when she tried to get something out of the closet in the playroom. Then, the mimic. One afternoon while the kids were playing outside, I heard my daughter call out, "Mommy?" from one of the bedrooms. I answered back, but she didn't reply. I walked over to the room that it sounded like she'd called from, but once I got there, I was able to see her and the rest of our kids out the window. They were playing at the little graveyard, which is too far down the yard to hear her from, especially as clearly as I did. Refusing to accept this immediately, I opened the window and I yelled out to her, asking what she was calling me for. She looked confused. She started to run closer and shouted, "I didn't call you, Mommy." Part of me knew that already, though. Then on two separate occasions, something mimicked my husband. I was home alone, the kids were at school, husband at the store. And I hear the unmistakable sound of my husband coughing. I was completely freaked out this time. I knew the sound so well, and I just couldn't believe that that had just happened. When I told my husband about this, he was truly freaked out, saying that he was definitely considering getting us a new place if things were going to keep messing with me. The last time, I was reading something in the kitchen. My husband was sitting on the couch in the living room, which you can see from the kitchen table. Suddenly, I hear my husband's voice, first clearing his throat, and then saying, "Sorry about that. What did you say?" The voice, the sound, it came from the left side of the house, the no-no side. As the throat clearing began, I was looking right at my husband, and now he was looking right at me. Genuinely freaked out, he jumped up and exclaimed that was enough. He got on his computer and started researching. Long story short, the research really just ended up being my husband looking for a new house. He said he wasn't interested in dealing with the previous owners, even if they were deceased. I couldn't argue with him. I too thought it might be nice to not question my sanity day in and day out. So we moved, and I haven't had anything like that happen since. So, does anyone else have any experiences with a mimic? And what exactly do you think their purpose is? I'm a corrections officer at a county jail in northwest Alabama. I work a 12-hour night shift from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. Most nights are calm, and not much happens from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. And other nights, you're moving nonstop, and police officers are constantly bringing people in. You have a lot of DUIs and junkies on the weekends. And then, anything from an FTA to the occasional murder throughout the regular work week. Anyways, like I said, most nights are calm, meaning that hours feel like days, and sometimes a single shift can make you feel like you've been there for weeks. But sometimes, those calm nights are not really calm at all. We have two holding cells in the front of the jail, used to house inmates that have recently been booked in and are waiting to see a nurse for a screening before going into Gen Pop. We have another room up front that we call the pink room. Due to the walls and ceiling being painted a hot pink color, because a former sheriff thought that hot pink was a calming color, everyone hates this room. It's also our drunk tank, equipped with a camera for observation and a flushable drain in the floor for any fluids that might come out of someone. You know what I mean. One night, after lights out, when everyone was asleep, I heard a loud bang in one of the holding cells, like someone was hitting or kicking the door, which would have been a normal noise if anyone would have been inside one of them. But my partner and I had moved everyone out of the two holding cells just a few hours ago, and no one else had come in that night. I thought it might have been the guy that we were keeping in the pink room for medical observation. But when I looked over at the monitor for the camera in there, he was sound asleep on his mat on the floor. I went over to the doors of the holding cells to investigate. I lifted the heavy curtains on the windows so that I could see into each one. But there was no sign of anything. I figured I could have been hearing things, since that noise was so commonly heard at all times, day or night. I went back over to my desk and I just sat down. It was about 2:45 when I heard that noise, and it was completely silent until about 3:05. I started hearing the noise that it makes when a door is unlocked from the control room. From the control room, you can unlock or open any door in the facility, except for like three that you need an actual key for. There is a door right behind the desk that I sit at. It leads to the kitchen and the rec yard. That was the door that sounded like it was unlocked. I radioed my partner, who was in the control room, and asked if she had unlocked this door. She said that she hadn't touched the computer since I'd asked her to let me outside, which was like 2 hours ago. Again, I thought it was a common noise to be heard. The silence is playing tricks on me. But I heard it again, except this time, it sounded like the front door I looked over at the monitors for the front door and I saw nothing. But on the monitor for the pink room, I could see the screen starting to get fuzzy, like static. Then it went completely black for a few seconds. When the camera came back on, the inmate was sleeping in the same spot. But everything that he had in there with him, his cup, shoes, blanket, they were scattered across the whole room. I would have heard him moving and throwing things, but it was completely quiet for those few seconds that the camera was black. After that, I decided I didn't want to be alone anymore. I went up to the control room with my partner, and I started telling her what was going on. After I told her about the doors unlocking and locking, and about the guy's stuff in the pink room, she just laughed and said, "Must have been Christine." My partner had been working there for about 5 years. She told me that Christine was an inmate that had died in the old jail next door, and that the reason she haunts this jail is because the buildings are connected. She told me about numerous things that have happened while she was on shift, including an actual sighting of the ghost that she calls Christine. She said that Christine has gray hair down to her shoulders, wearing a white nightgown. She also said that Christine can be seen walking down hallways on the cameras, inside the cells, with her hands on the bars, looking through them. And sometimes, you can see her face from the windows outside. I haven't seen anything like that, but I'll be sure to post if I do. When I was little, I saw the ghosts of two boys that used to live on my street. For some context, this was at the first house I lived in, and I was around 4 or 5. Keep in mind, I had a pretty overactive imagination as a kid, but this encounter felt so real and unlike anything I've experienced beforehand. But anyway, let's get into the story. I woke up in the middle of the night in my mother's room. I forgot why I was in my mother's room, but I remember that she was sleeping, and her room was lightened enough that I was able to look around the room. But when I looked towards her bedroom door, I saw two white figures playing. They appeared to be young, as they seemed smaller than, say, my father, and seemed around a little older than people my age that I knew. They also weren't transparent. These figures had actual mass to them. Like shadow people is the best way to describe it, but instead of black, they were white. Anyways, when I saw them, they stopped playing and stared right at me. My whole body froze, and I was unable to say anything. I didn't even want to wake my mother. I was that frightened to move. Then, the two figures started to walk to me as excruciatingly slow as possible. As they crossed over to my side of the bed, one of the boys had reached his hand out to touch me, and then faded away just as he reached me. It wasn't until a few years later when I brought this up with my dad, and he told me that he used to see a bunch of ghosts when he was a kid at our house. He grew up in my first house, but he never saw ghosts of two children. He did say that he heard a story growing up, that there were two boys that had died on the street that we lived on. One died falling down the stairs, and the other died in some other way that he couldn't recall. But he also didn't know these boys personally. That's all I've got. I've told a few people this, and they brought up sleep paralysis. But I felt like I could move. I was just afraid to move in that moment. I did say that I had an overactive imagination back then, so it is entirely possible that I imagined it all. But it felt so real, and unlike any night terror that had been made up by my imagination. If you have any explanations, that would be awesome. But for now, I'll sign off on that note. In my bedroom, the TV sits on the same wall as my bedroom door. So when sitting up, you can see the door. Oftentimes, I close my door, but at night, I tend to leave it open, just a crack, so my cat can come in and out easily. The door itself isn't one that swings open lightly, as it slightly rubs against the carpet. But my cat is no small boy, so he pushes through the crack, opening the door slightly, relatively easily. So I'm used to the noise of the door rubbing against the carpet, and I'm used to seeing my door slightly more open when he enters. Tonight, I was propped up, sitting forward on my bed. My room was dark. The only light was from the TV itself. In that moment, I'm setting the sleep timer on the TV. So, it gets even darker in my room. I hear the sound of my door rubbing against the carpet, and I see my door begin to open further. It stops where it normally would, slightly more open. But then it just keeps opening. I leaned even more forward to see where my cat was, and how he managed to do that. I see no cat. I look behind me, and my cat is sleeping on the pillows against my headboard. I have no idea what opened my door. So this is a true story that happened when I was in the fifth grade. We lived across the street from a broken-down building, and next to the building had a basketball hoop. Me and my brother would play there all the time. Now, the basketball hoop and the building, they don't really have anything to do with the story. It's more to set the scene. To get to the basketball hoop, we had to cross a main street. I live in a small town, so we had very few streets like this. But again, I was in the fifth grade, and my brother was in the seventh grade. So one day, we were walking to the basketball hoop, and we hit the street. I'm a jumpy little kid, and I go to cross the street when a white car, with no driver, as I remember, came and hit me. Now, as soon as this happened, I woke up. It's just a silly little dream. Right. Well, the next night, I had the same dream. And the next night. And the next night. This went on for about a week or two. So because of this, I decided not to go to the basketball hoop anymore. But one day, my brother wants me to go over there. And at the time, me and my brother were kind of disconnected. So I was actually happy he wanted to do something with me. We walk over to the basketball hoop. I go to cross the street. And of course, a white car with no driver is just about to hit me. But my brother pulls me onto the sidewalk without a second thought. He saves my life. It was his idea to not tell my parents, because he thought even though he saved me, they'd be mad at me and him for being careless. But it happened about 2 or 3 days later. Same exact car had now nearly killed me twice. This all happened on the same street around the same time. And to this day, I still can't explain it. Every time it was about to hit me, my brother saved me, and we would look at the car as it continued driving. Then, later, I learned something. When I was very little, like younger than I was at that time, my mom had an all-white car that looked exactly like the one we'd seen. And apparently, one night, she was drunk and nearly hit a kid on the same crosswalk. We moved from that house about less than a year later, but it's a small town, so I do walk by the basketball hoop all the time. But I've yet to cross the street in the same spot. So, what do you think was really happening here? About 4 years ago, I moved to Seattle. I was renting a studio in Pioneer Square, and though Seattle can be rough, I never actually had issues around my building. Carried my pepper spray, but never had to use it. Sometimes, when walking alone, I'll glance behind me every now and again, usually to make sure no one's following me. Or if someone's behind me, I become aware of that person, moving out of the way if necessary, or getting my pepper spray in the event they try something funny. I turned around as a force of habit and saw that there was someone behind me, a tall, bald man in a suit carrying a briefcase. Nothing too sketchy about it, I thought, but I did a double take. He was wearing sunglasses. I thought that part was strange right away, being as it was 8 o'clock at night. People being out and about made sense, but there definitely wasn't any more sun to shade. I couldn't hear any footsteps, but I figured that was the heavy rain's fault. Eventually, still a few blocks from my building, I hear what sounds like someone running. So I move closest to the street, nervously, preparing to cross if I had to. I turn to see what the heck the running's about, but there's no one there. I glance around as I kept walking, but couldn't decide where this guy went or where the running came from. Rounding the corner to the street of my building, out of my periphs, I see someone behind me, close behind me, and they behave a lot like the man in the sunglasses. Anxiety kicks in and I turn around to see. It's definitely the same man. I pick up the pace, but it sounds like they're right behind me. Without a second thought, I shuffle up towards the next building, through its well-lit parking lot, and to its doorway. It's not my building, but at least I'd be somewhere with people. At least he wouldn't know where I lived. I could still hear footsteps. Quick glance tells me that he's still close. So, with pepper spray in hand, I stop near the door, turn around firmly. No one's there. I'm confused, and then terrified again. A couple blocks down is my building. And standing in front of my building's entrance is Sunglasses Man. There was no way this man got from behind me to my building in that amount of time. With the man standing there, I decided to go in the opposite direction, to the closest bar. But as I walked away, I felt my legs literally turn to jello. I could see that he was walking away too, and I was scared. I thought, should I call the police? Phone in hand, I looked behind me again. No one. I looked up towards the buildings, and nobody there either. I was about to put my phone away as I went across the street to the bar, figuring I might as well chill out with a drink. But I can't cross the street. Because crossing the street, coming right towards me, is the same man. Realize it's not every evening that you see someone appear and reappear in other places, like defying logic and time, or defying actual sidewalks and highways, literal structures. It wasn't even possible, but here I was. I quickly dial 911, put the phone in my pocket, and book it in the opposite direction as quickly as possible. I buzz myself into my door, close the door immediately, and look out. The man was standing at the edge of my parking lot. I swear, I thought he was going to do something really cliche and creepy, like wave or smile. But he just stood there, facing me. I heard the faint sound of someone talking, and I hesitated to turn around again. It was, "Hello? Hello? Are you there?" 911. I fumbled for my phone, apologizing and explaining the situation to the operator. She asked if he was still standing there, but he wasn't. She sent a couple of officers out that night. I wouldn't say they didn't believe me, more that they weren't believing this man was transporting from place to place. They floated the idea that it was possibly more than one person. It felt dismissive, but I didn't have any other explanations either. I never saw the man again, but I haven't lived in Seattle for almost 2 years. Curious if anyone else in the area has ever had an encounter like this one. Seen someone do something that you couldn't explain. This was many years ago. I was about 15 at the time, so living at home with my family. I was home alone, though, in our basement/playroom, watching TV. I remember that I was getting caught up on Prison Break, while my mom, my dad, and my sister were visiting my grandparents. I stayed back because I was just over at their house earlier in the day, and I just wanted some time to watch what I wanted to watch. I was enjoying the show, but then I heard a thump upstairs. I knew that this was wrong. It felt off. My family wasn't home, and wouldn't be for a while. Plus, the front door made quite a ruckus when being opened. It wasn't like I had any weapons near me. So, instead, I just hopped up, and I moved out of sight from the basement door as I figured out what to do next. I was next to the entertainment center now, and I recalled that in the drawers there were flashlights. Also, there was this lamp sitting next to me, which in that moment I thought this would make a decent weapon. So I grabbed that too. Holding a flashlight in one hand and a lamp in the other, I just stood there. Suddenly, I had the distinct feeling that someone was behind me. But I knew that wasn't possible. My back was against a wall, with nothing but the outside on the other side. Either way, I was not against the wall anymore. Quickly, I turned around, and I saw nothing. Then I looked back towards the stairs to the basement door. Now I felt more uncomfortable down here. so uncomfortable that I booked it to the staircase. With the items in hand, and I ran up the stairs, slamming the basement door. I then took a breath, but I scanned the entire upstairs area, and I heard something in the kitchen. Just movement, but it was coming from that direction. That's also where the phone was. I tried to concentrate on exactly where the noise was coming from. Then it stopped. I rounded the corner and I ran into the kitchen, waving my lamp and turning on the flashlight, hoping that it really would blind someone if I pointed it at them. But I realized no one was there. I turned on the kitchen light, but still, nothing there. Then I heard a loud bang on the door, and I felt someone was really there. When I checked the peephole, it looked like a package delivery person jogging away. That was strange, I thought. It was late, and I wasn't going to open the door to see what they delivered. So, false alarm, I thought. Then I looked away from the peephole, and I saw a person just standing outside of our window. I thought to myself, maybe this would be a good time to grab that phone. Not taking my eyes away from the window, I turned on the outdoor lights. But again, no one was there. I wasn't sure what to think, but my mind went straight to someone was messing with me. I didn't know why or how, but it just had to be. Then, another sound coming from the door. It sounded like muffled talking, and once the door opened, I could see that it was my family. But how did I know that this was my family if they were wearing masks? And why were they wearing masks? I thought I said something like, "Hey guys, what the heck? You think you're funny?" But it wasn't until after I said this I saw they had bats. I went to arm myself with the lamp, but somehow it did no good, and they were already to where I was standing, whacking me with their bats, then grabbing me, suffocating me, choking me. I jolted up, awake, on the couch. I said to myself out loud, I was dreaming. Then I heard the door start to open from upstairs. I thought I might pass out. It was my family, but they weren't here to hurt me. It took me a minute to realize that, though, as I laid there just listening to them having their normal conversations. As I laid there listening, I realized that my neck was incredibly sore. I didn't talk to my family about my dream, and I didn't bother explaining anything at the time. But when they went to bed, I went to the bathroom. I could see faint red marks around my whole neck. I rubbed it for a minute, and then I decided to go to bed in my own room. I never had an experience like this again, and I'm much older now. But to this day, I still remember that dream, if you can even call it that. Being a pretty avid camper, I've seen my fair share of dangerous things in the woods, but nothing I would consider unexplained. All except what I saw more than once while camping in Oregon. It was the same campsite 2 years in a row. It is, by all accounts, an awesome campsite, and I will intentionally leave their name out because I don't know that this story is exactly encouraging visitors. Usually, regardless of where I am, I'm the last one awake. Camping especially, I really enjoy just stargazing, listening to nature, poking at the fire, eventually putting it out for good. It's nice. And it was nice at this time, too, until it sounded like someone put headphones on me, where everything I had been hearing was now muted. But there was something I hadn't heard before. The sound of something moving around slowly in the trees surrounding our tents. I immediately grabbed the flashlight. I started to shine it around, not sure what I expected to see, and suddenly, I could hear again. No longer could I hear footsteps, but instead, nature seemed very loud now. My flashlight met something that I can describe, but I can't explain. Something standing in the trees. Then I realized it was hunched over, not facing me. It appeared to be naked, as in no fur, no clothes, and it looked gray. I was pretty horrified to see that it was very muscular, and its legs bent backwards, like a bird's would. I saw its face only briefly, making out just two very large and almost reflective eyes. This was just as it turned towards me in my light, before leaping backwards, retreating further into the woods. I didn't sleep easy this time around, and we left the next day. Not because of this, but man, that was good timing for me, because I couldn't have stayed another night. The next year, we went back to the same campground and campsite. Like I said, great place for many reasons. Per the usual, I stayed up, poking at the fire and reading. It was maybe 2 in the morning when I heard something moving around the trees. Grabbing my flashlight, I shined in the area that I'd heard the noise. I couldn't believe that the same creature was there. It looked exactly the same as I'd remembered from the previous year. Exactly the same, but this time I could see its face, and I could see it standing. It had to be at least 6 feet tall, and the face was very wide. But I had been right about those eyes. They were huge, and even though they essentially were reflecting the light, they were very, very dark, completely black, like a doll's plastic or marble eyes. The legs, the same. I mean, this is a pretty unique-looking thing, so I definitely know that it was the same. What was it, though? Still don't have any answers to that, really. I haven't been back to that specific campsite either. Luckily, there's a new place I found that's absolutely incredible. Best of all, no strange, leathery gray giants. Camping is much nicer without them, I must say. When I was younger, my mom unintentionally released spirits, or some sort of powerful evil energy, into our home. Growing up, I've realized that it was a bit careless, but I also can't imagine the kind of pain that she was going through. At the time, I was 7, and my sister was 3. My dad had just been killed. He was a police officer and was shot to death on the job while trying to break up a domestic dispute. I know all of this as an adult, but part of me knew it as a child, too. So anyways, we were living in a new house with none of our own stuff. A furnished apartment, really. My mom had sold all of our stuff or put it in storage. For whatever reason, at the time, we weren't doing well financially. I'm sure like most things, it was attributed to my dad's death. But whatever the reason, we downgraded. I would sometimes hear my mom awake, talking to someone. I assumed for a while she was talking to my dad. I did that sometimes too. But one night, I remember having a terrible dream. I'd woken up suddenly and cried myself to my mom's room. When I burst through her door, I could see that she had candles lit, and she was playing with some sort of game. It was a Ouija board. I didn't know what that was then, but I sure do now. My mom stopped what she was doing that night, and she let me sleep in her room. But I felt terrible in there, almost as terrible as I did in my dream. I remember just covering myself in her sheets and snuggling as close to her as possible. From then on, there was a lot of strange stuff. My mom would constantly be using this board, sometimes even locking her bedroom door, which was scary for me at the time. I remember begging her to let me in. I also remember hearing her begging to someone for something. I didn't know what, but she sounded desperate. Every day, it seemed like she would tell me not to go near the board, not to ever play with the board. I didn't want to play with the board, I would tell her. And that was the truth. I was terrified of this thing, convinced it's what gave me these awful feelings and nightmares. Then my mom started praying every night. No pun intended, she did this religiously. To the point where she would have alarms set on the microwave to remind her to pray. One night, she woke me up, my sister in her arms. She told me to get up, scooting me around my room, telling me it was time to go pray. We were now in the hallway. My mom brought us all to our knees and said to repeat after her and close our eyes. I don't remember how this particular event ended. I just know that she was apologizing, showing so much remorse for not praying that night. This was her reaction anytime she missed a prayer. One time, I didn't listen. I didn't close my eyes. Black nothingness filled the corner of my mother's room, which I could see from the hallway. It wasn't moving towards us, but it was pulsating. It was like a heartbeat of blackness. Complete nothingness, void of all anything. I never opened my eyes again when praying. The last experience I recall was when I was sleeping in my mother's bed, as was my little sister. I'd woken up suddenly, and my mother had too. She brought me and my sister close, covering my eyes weakly with her hand. I couldn't see anything, but I could feel my mother shake, and I could hear her whimper a bit. Then I heard, or we all heard, the sound of something huge scratching the wall behind us. My little sister was woken up by this and was crying. I was crying, and my mom went to turn on the light. We would see what the noise had been, but have no idea what exactly made it. Three large, deep scratches covered the wall. They looked like they could have been made by only a huge tiger, very large cat. This continues to be something I have a hard time reconciling with. It's usually this detail that makes people go from, oh, your mom was struggling, to, oh, maybe there really was something evil going on. Those scratches stayed on the wall for a long time. My mom started sleeping in my room, and so did my sister on most nights. It wasn't until we were moving out that my mom was forced to go back into that room and do something with the wall. She wallpapered it, making it look almost good as new. The owners, or the new tenants, would likely never be aware of the damages that took place there. Hopefully, they would also be free of any paranormal experiences, too. Back in 2017, I used to live with my aunt in Minnesota. And while living with her, I had worked at a nearby Walgreens, which was about a 35-40 minute bike ride from her place. This happened on my way home after working the closing shift. Now, being somebody who does believe in paranormal and just bad stuff in general, I was always a little bit nervous making this bike ride at night, but mainly just because my mind would go wild. The route I take home is somewhat isolated. I have to go past a park in a lot of wooded areas. It's barely lit up. There aren't many streetlights or houses. I had just gotten to the park area where it's more naturey and woodsy. I was talking to an ex on the phone. They were currently my girlfriend at the time, as a way to ease my nerves on the way home. I had briefly looked down at my phone when I heard a weird, screeching sound, which caused me to look up. To my horror, there was a large, tall, deathly frail humanoid creature. It looked very white and pale, almost as if it was sickly. Before I could really get a good look at it, it dropped onto all fours and leapt into the wooded area. Seeing this, I panicked and began to pedal as fast as I could. Meanwhile, I could hear the thing taking chase, but remaining hidden in the woods. I could hear branches constantly snapping, leaves crunching. This thing was in pursuit and out of view. I got about halfway through the route, to the point where nature stops being trees and woods and opens up into rolling hills, sort of flat grasslands. As soon as I got to this point, I heard the thing stop chasing me in complete silence. That's when I noticed a very peculiar scent. Blueberry pie, which really weirded me out because there are no houses, restaurants, or buildings of any kind in this area. So for the scent of a freshly baked blueberry pie, my favorite pie, seemed really sketchy. I paid no attention to it. As to me, it was coming from the distant hills, as if this thing was somehow creating the scent to draw me away from the sidewalk and towards it. So I kept pedaling, and eventually I made it to where the townhomes were, and back home safely. Which, yes, I did throw my bike into the garage and run inside up to my bedroom like a frightened child, just turned on the TV and the light. Now, it doesn't end there. Just a few days later, when I started forgetting about the thing that I had seen, I spent the day handing out candy for my aunt on Halloween. And I was watching YouTube until it was time to retire to bed. Shortly after I had gone to my room, I again heard that weird screeching sound. And for some reason, my idiot self decided to check out the window. And there, about 40-50 feet away from the house, standing underneath a few trees, was the creature thingy, which made me quickly just close the window and shut the blinds. The next day, surprisingly, my aunt asked if I had heard the sounds last night and if I had seen the thing as well. From what she told me, she'd heard the noises too and wanted to see what was going on. So she took the dog and went into the backyard and had seen the thing standing there. Almost immediately, it dropped to all fours and leapt away. Now, when it comes to this thing's size, I'd say it stands on 2 feet. It's about 7 to 8 feet tall. And I'm 6'5", so it was quite taller than me. It looked very pale, like it was nothing but skin and bones. Yet, it moved incredibly fast, leaping the way that it did, and keeping speed, if not going faster, than my bike. If you have any thoughts on what this is, I'm curious, because other than being terrifying, I have no idea. The first paranormal thing I ever experienced was when I was about 11 years old or so. I'm at my great aunt's house, spending the night with my cousins. We're in my older cousin's room watching kid movies on VHS. She's gone at a friend's house spending the night. Me and my favorite cousin are on the bed, while my brother and little cousin were on the ground watching the movie. I guess I somehow fell asleep without remembering that I laid down or even closing my eyes. I wake up in the middle of the night, laying still on the bed, when I see in the middle of the hallway, floating near the chandelier, is a shadow-like man with those old-fashioned hats. Whenever I blinked, he disappeared. Now, he was in the mirror, where it looked like he was standing next to my brother and little cousin. I blink again, and it's standing right next to me. I closed my eyes and oddly fell back asleep right away. At first, I thought it was a dream, but I realized it couldn't be if I saw that my brother and little cousin were sleeping on the floor, which I didn't know was going to happen because I assumed they were just going to watch the movie with us and go to sleep in the living room like usual. I told my aunt about it, and my older cousin believed me and talked about how they had paranormal things happen to them. It's weird because I saw on these shows of people who had sleep paralysis, they saw the same figure as me, which made me realize, did I even move my body and head when I was looking at this figure? Or was I in sleep paralysis? Well, friends, that's the end of tonight's episode. Thank you for listening, and thank you for sharing. Be sure to tune in for the season finale of The Darkest Hour, Friday, November 27th at 11 p.m., right here on neoretrofm.com. Do you have stories like these? I'd love to share them for season 2 of The Darkest Hour. Send them to me. AmandaDarkestHour@gmail.com or on Reddit, AmandaJaneFMN. Stay spooky.